Point Church coming up. Palm Sunday weekend is one of the biggest weekends at River Point, and I don't want you to miss it. It's our baptism weekend. Now, I know many of you were baptized as an infant. It was a decision your parents made. It was beautiful. People cried. You wore a little outfit. But you don't remember it. Baptism is different, talked about in the New Testament. Jesus talked about baptism in this way. He said, believe and be baptized. So here's what that means. What that means is you got to come to a place in your life where you believe Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins, that he was buried and he rose again. That's what baptism symbolizes. So what I'm asking you to be a part of, at least consider this as part of your faith walk with God, is you decide that you need to be baptized. It's a commandment in the New Testament, in the book of Mark, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So you consider it for yourself as a follower of Christ. That's all I'm asking you to do. Listen, I know it's a big decision, but you decide for you to be baptized. Being baptized at Palm Sunday weekend is perfect. Right around the Easter, where we celebrate the resurrection of Christ. Baptism is about celebrating the death, burial, and the resurrection of Christ. And I don't want you to miss out on this. Last year, we baptized over 150 people on Palm Sunday weekend. Don't miss it. This is your year. Here's what you do. There's a card in the worship center when you come to church. There's also a place on our website at riverpoint.org. Sign up. Be brave. It's not about church membership. I don't get a commission if you get baptized. This is what it's about. Your obedience to Christ as a follower. So believe and be baptized. All right?
Man, if that doesn't get you excited about baptism, get on a clap. Come on. I know it's a little hyper. We've been showing that for the last couple of weekends because this is a big emphasis for us. You know, we're a non-denominational church, and we don't do an altar call at the end of every service for people to come forward. We believe that the Bible's clear that the public profession of your faith is through baptism, and we celebrate that in a big way. We have people coming from every walk of life, from every religious background, many people from no religious background. This is the thing that unites us, a public testimony of your faith in Jesus Christ by being baptized. I know if you grew up with a tradition that's different than this, this is a weird deal. And I want to challenge you and really to think through this and to look at your Bible and to see what happens, see what God says that you should be doing, okay? So be baptized. You can go at either campus and talk to the people out front. They'd love to help you get signed up for that. Well, I'm hyped because I am caffeinated and I am well, finally, after 2 weeks. I got a text message from somebody in our Missouri City campus. They felt my pain all the way there. So thank you for your prayers, Missouri City. We always like to welcome you. I'm glad you're there at Elkins High School. If you're visiting with us, this is perfect. Please go by and see Scott Denton. He'd love to meet you and our whole staff down there. They'd love to say hi. I also want to recommend or remind everybody that we just celebrated this week 1 year at our West End campus. We just celebrated 1 year. We got about 150 people coming. It's really hard work. I'm down there on Sunday nights, and it is hard. We are renovating a building. We've got just a great team of people doing this, and we're hoping to be in there. Well, we are going to be in there the 1st of October, which is very quick, and we're very excited to be able to offer the 1st of November Sunday morning services as well as Sunday night, so we don't know what to do. If you know anybody inside the loop, please let them know that we're down there on Sunday evenings at 5 o'clock. We meet at St. Thomas High School, so we'd love to have you to tell your friends about that. Well, we've been in Psalms. Oh, I had to say hi to my mom. Hey, Mom. I'll be there next week. I'm coming, okay? Good. Okay, so that's good out of the way. Listen, we're in Psalm 23. We started it last week. It's the most familiar psalm you'll read, right? We read it in our services. We've talked about it. We talked about the first three verses last week, and I'm going to try to cover the rest of it today. And if it's familiar for you, let me just put it back on the screen. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake." And there's a break there. And that break there is kind of like, this is all the stuff we love to think about. about God being our shepherd and about green pastures and about rest and about still waters, whatever that means, right? And the fact that God leads us, man, that's awesome. We all buying into that. But the reason the psalm is so helpful for our daily relationship with our Creator is that it covers every span of life. I mean, really, good times and bad. And that's where it takes a turn today in chapter 23, verse 4. We're going to see this turn. This is the part that really grabs us, right? And I'm going to try to explain it a little bit to you. All right, here we go. Ready? Verse 4. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. If you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies, you anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So let's go back to that first phrase on chapter verse 4. It says this: even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Are you with me on this? All right, let's say this one out loud together. We're going to put it back on the screen. Even in Elkins High School, Missouri City campus, I want you to say it out loud. Here we go. Ready? Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Now, what does this mean? We kind of have an idea. What is the valley of shadow of death? Sounds like a very spooky place, doesn't it? And it is. There's a turn. You see the turn? The turn is from lying in green pastures and having plenty of water to this valley. And it really depicts so clearly our life. I mean, one day we're doing great, and then the next day we're not. I mean, it's just this quick turn, this one thing that happens. I mean, all of a sudden we go through this valley. And what I like about this passage of Scripture, it's so comforting for me, is the idea that when we go through difficult times, we can rest assured that's a natural part of life. That there's good times and there's bad times. Somehow, though, I, like you, are surprised by the difficulties in life. They just sort of come upon us, and from time to time I feel like it's not fair, I don't deserve it, this is beyond me, and we're just sort of taken back. We're not prepared ever for it. Somehow, even as believers, as followers of God, we're pushing and pushing and pushing for this idea that God's supposed to make all of our life circumstances easy, comfortable, great. It doesn't work that way. And if David, the king, can talk about the valley of shadow of death, man, then we ought to be prepared. We ought to understand this. I know this isn't the most optimistic future that a pastor can paint for you here, but you're either in a valley, coming out of a valley, or going into a valley. Praise the Lord, huh? That's the good news. What did the pastor tell you today at church? Well, it's going to get hard, it was hard, or it's going to be hard. You know, I mean, it's just, that is life. We live in a broken place. Things don't work the way they're supposed to. I mean, it's crazy. And so these valleys are, and they range. What David was talking about here, and he was really tugging on the geography of the Holy Land there. In fact, there's a city named Petra in the southern Jordan, whose entry to the city is in this sort of valley. And what happens is, at the lowest point, these winter streams come through and erode away this valley and create these huge cliffs on both sides. And so it narrows. So you can see in this poetry that David's writing here that he goes from these very open fields where there's green grass everywhere you see, and the shepherd is leading you from great place to great place to great place where there's plenty of water, and when you feel full, you lay down and you rest. It's a great thing. To turning the corner, and you go down through this valley. Now, the valley is a difficult place because you don't see wide open spaces anymore. In fact, your vision gets narrow. And I think that's symbolic of what happens to us in crisis. That's all we can see is the trouble. I mean, instead of looking at all of our possibilities and all of our options and all the good things that are happening and all the green grass and all the other fields, we all of a sudden get simple. You know, our life gets narrow. Our future becomes very restricted. And all of a sudden, we're just in this valley. And there's not a lot of options. It's that proverbial place in your life that you come to that you say, you know, it just looks like a no-win situation everywhere I turn. It's those kind of difficult places. It's loss, it's hardship, it's all those things. It's when the phone rings and you get this phone call in the middle of the night that something bad has happened. I sleep when I sleep, I put my phone by my bed because as a pastor with a big congregation, if the phone rings in the middle of the night, it ain't ever good news. Nobody's ever called me at 3 in the morning and go, "Pastor, I just want to let you know I love you. I just think you're amazing. God woke me up to tell you that." Don't do that. I sleep pretty sad, but you know, because once I'm up, I'm up. You know, I mean, I can't go back to sleep. That phone rings, and I recognize every time I see Life Flight take off, which at the Richmond campus here, the hospital is located right up the road, and the helicopter is based there. And that helicopter takes off a couple times a day. And when you see that helicopter take off, you recognize somebody's having a really bad day, and somebody's going through a tough valley. And it just reminds me, when I see those helicopters, pray for whoever they're going to go pick up, because it's a tough time. It's a difficult day. And all of us are going through the valley. That's what David is saying. It's not when, but when. It's not when or if. It's even though I'm going through this tough time. This is what he's saying here. This is it. You know, we're going through this very difficult time. The Hebrew word in there for valley is the deepest, darkest place you can be. Now, some of you there today, some of you get this. Some of you haven't lived long enough to get this. You know, your valley is, you know, not sitting at the right table at the middle school lunchroom, you know, I mean, and that's a valley. It's a big deal if you're in middle school, but it gets worse from here. Okay, so, see, I'm not alone in that. I mean, right? I mean, y'all been through a valley. Say something. Oh, God. I thought, man, I'm just the most pessimistic pastor you'll ever meet. But this is real life. This is difficulty. This is struggle. This is it. Now, here's a couple of encouragements. I've tried to pull out something positive about this deal. And here's the positive that David's trying to communicate. One is everybody's going through it. Now, if you look at this, we're reminded that this is common. Sometimes, I don't know if you're like me, but sometimes when you're going through a difficult time, you feel like you're the only one that somehow somebody's picking on you. That God's picking on you or somebody's picking on you, that you, this isn't fair. Everybody else's life is going so well, isn't it? And then we look at our own and go, why can't I have that? Listen, let me just tell you, this is free sermon material right here. Stop looking at everybody's life through Instagram. Nobody is posting their valley. Nobody. I'm going to start doing that. No, I'm just going to say, oh, I had a rough day. Here it is. And then put that Ludwig filter on it, and it makes it look so beautiful. You know, it's just everybody on Twitter is posting their best possible moment in that day. And our kids, and some of us as adults, look at that and go, look at this, man. It's just one blessing after another. Wow, this is incredible. And then we take a picture of our own life, and we go, well, we can't post that. That stinks. You know, my life is in a terrible place. You know, I'm going to start posting. But y'all need to follow me on Twitter, okay? Because I got a speeding ticket this weekend, and when I get a speeding ticket, which I don't normally get because I have this famous line I say, regardless of where I'm at or what time of the year, I always say to the police officer, very respectfully, is there any Christmas spirit left? I always say that. But I was in Brookshire. They ain't got no Christmas spirit up there. They ain't got no Christmas spirit up there. In Brookshire. Post that on your Twitter. So I took a picture in my rearview mirror of the lights going off and this deal. Post a, man, today's just incredible. Beep. You know, that kind of, nobody's posting that. Nobody. You don't got a flat time. You don't post an argument, a selfie with your wife as you're having an argument. All right, yeah, hang on, let's get a picture of this. Kink. You don't do it. Your kids rebel you. You don't have a lot of pictures of your kids smoking dope. You know, hearing a boom. Look at this. My life's falling apart. I just want to share it with everybody on Twitter. Nobody's doing that. And it gives us a false sense that everything's going good for everybody else. It's such a deception. It's so awful. I'm telling you, man, I've talked to so many teenage girls and guys in high school that feel like they're getting cheated because everybody else gets the thing that they're tweeting about. And I'm going, man, look for the bad day on Twitter. You'll never find it on Instagram. Never. Except for me. I'm going to start doing this. You should follow me. Okay, so everybody's going through this. And here's another thing that's encouragement. This is going to wreck your theology. But based on this scripture, the indication is the Lord is my shepherd. He leads me even through the valley of shadow of death. God did not abandon David, and all of a sudden he found himself in trouble. Think about this theologically. God led him through the valley. God led him there. That messes with your theology because there's some sort of merit-demerit theology that we boast about in our life that we say, well, when we're walking with God and we're right with God and we're spending time with God and we show up at church on a weekend, right, even daylight savings time, stuff like that, and we're really good and we volunteer and we give a little money, somehow we feel like God's going to bless us. And when things aren't going well in our circumstances, somehow we feel at times, not every time, but go with me on this, we feel like somehow that God's abandoned us or left us or it's being unfair to us. And we have this health, wealth, and prosperity gospel that's ingrained into us that says, if I do good, God's obligated, and my life is going to be good. Now, listen, it might be good. I'm not going to take that away from you, but it doesn't mean it won't be hard. You won't have these valleys in your life that are deep, dark places. Maybe God led you to this valley to build your faith, you know? Maybe you needed this valley. Now, the other encouragement thing about this passage, if you read it closely, it says here that he leads me through the valley. David knew and understood that this wasn't an ending point, that he's going through something. This was a season. It was time. It was a time in his life. It was part of the journey. Now that's important to remember when you're going through a difficult time, because for you and me, if we're not real careful, the devil will give you this lie that this is your plight in life, that things will always be hard, that things will always be challenging, that there's always going to be a valley of shadow of death. It'll take away your hope. And you got to be careful about this, because this is something we go through. Maybe the shepherd has to lead the sheep through the valley of darkness to get to the green pastures and the still waters that still awaited and needed by the sheep. So things aren't going good all the time. Now, this is critical to understand, because many of us have walked away from God in anger and faith because we just didn't feel like God arranged our circumstances or did something in our life that we felt like a good, loving God should do. We have to factor in this idea that God is our shepherd, means he's leading us through things in life, good times and bad times, that God in no way is abandoning us, but the ideal here is that God is leading us, taking us through there. Now, here's a couple other things. Are y'all still with me? Okay, I didn't hear anybody in Missouri City, but okay, here we go. He leads me, he says, even though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, here's the phrase, I will fear no evil. That means I will not. This is the biggest problem when times get tough. It's not the evil things that could happen to you. It's the things that you fear will happen to you. Fear messes you up. I mean, it is a thing that attacks your thinking. It attacks your physical body. It attacks everything. Here's what I know about you. See if I'm not right. Because I say things that they're not all right, by the way. You should Google me or something, you know? Figure this out. But here's what I think that for most of us, all of us, right now, you're managing your fears. You're making decisions not based on what's right or wrong. Oftentimes, we're making decisions based on the least scary option. We're managing life, coping with life, oftentimes based on this path of least resistance that keep us away from the things that we fear. And we're trying to manage our lives quite independently, I may add, in a way that keeps us away from our fear. Now, everybody's fearful of something different. Like me, just to get real, I'll just share. This is oversharing, but I'm scared to death of rodents. I can handle snakes and spiders and bugs. If a bug landed on my face, I wouldn't care. But if a mouse ran through here, I am pulling up my skirt and running away. I mean, I can't handle it. I cannot handle rodents of any kind. Possums just creep me out, man. Are they dead? Are they not dead? What are they going on? They're just laying there. What's going on? You want to touch it? And then it goes, ah. Oh. Hate that, man. Hate that. It started when I was about 8. I told you the story before, but I'll remind you. This is where it all began for me. I was walking through my uncle's hunting cabin in Maryland, Uncle Clyde, and something fell on my shoulder. And I'm walking right through the threshold of the door. Something fell on my shoulder onto the ground, and I step on it, and I walk in. I go, what was that? And it was a mouse. And it's squirming. And I picked up my skirt and ran away, and I'm just going, oh, my God, it's a mouse. And Uncle Clyde goes, you scared of mice? I go, yeah, I am, Uncle Clyde. Thank you. He thought that was funny. And so I do things to avoid things I'm scared of. My wife's scared of snakes. She told me, she said, God or no God, if you put a plastic snake anywhere in this house, I will divorce you. I don't care how it looks. I know it's wrong. I won't be able to live with you anymore. Don't you ever do it. I've been married 28 years. You know how many times I've wanted to do that? But I know she ain't kidding, man. If I show up here one day single, you know what happened. She will not apologize. She said, I'll divorce. That's it. I'm done. Don't put a plastic snake. I wanted to put one in the washing machine. Ooh, wouldn't that be great? You know, that'd be so great. Yeah. What are you scared of? You know, there's these physical things that we're scared of. Sometimes it's spiders, snakes, and all that. But it's other things. It's failure. You know? It's you fear not being accepted. Yeah. You fear that you're not going to make it, you know, financially. You get that phone call from the doctor, and that creates a lot of fear. You fear that you'll be alone all your life. You know, you fear that life will never be the same. And so we manage our life in light of this fear. And David says something here just quite amazing. He says, you take me through this valley of the shadow of the darkest places in life where there's really no options except moving forward. Have you ever been in a place like that? There's no options except moving forward. It's hard when you lose somebody or your marriage falls apart or you get a divorce. It's not something you asked for. It just happened, and now you're in this valley. And what do? You want more options than you have. You don't have many except move forward. And so you move forward through this valley. And what God is hoping for us in this valley is that we'll understand his presence and cling to him in faith and sense that he is going to take care of us, that he hasn't stopped in the middle of the valley being our shepherd, even though times have gotten tough. And we got this idea that if we're not real careful, here's the thing. You'll start making decisions based on your fear instead of your faith. In fact, as I read the New Testament especially, let me tell you, the opposite of faith isn't doubt. It's fear. Fear and faith cannot coexist, but doubt and faith can. I can doubt God and believe in God at the same time. You see that in the New Testament with this father that brought his boy to Jesus. And he says, I do believe, help my unbelief. I feel like I live most of my life like that. I do believe, And also I don't, you know. And but this fear thing, if you're not careful, it will consume you. If you're scared of losing, you'll do everything you can do not to lose instead of doing everything possible to win. Do you understand the difference there? Prevent defense, you don't hear about them much anymore. After the Houston team lost to the Bills, remember that? Yeah, you lost a lot of money on that thing, didn't you? Yeah. Okay, we won't talk about that at church. But that's the idea. You just play not to lose. That's playing based on your fears. And David understands that, hey, I'm not going to fear in this valley, because if I fear in this valley, I'm going to lose my mind. I'm going to be confused. My thinking gets skewed. My emotions take over, and fear is an emotion that's deep-seated in our soul. And all of a sudden, it begins to drive us, and this fear actually can sort of debilitate you, shut you down, or make you, on the opposite extreme, make you do some of the stupidest things in the world that you never thought you were capable of doing, but you were so fearful of something, it drove you to do something that in a confused state you would have never done if you were right-minded. And so even in the valley, what I believe is possible, or at least David's presenting this option here, is that we don't have to be driven by our fears. That we can still, as followers of God, be driven by faith. That we can walk through this valley with faith. And here's why he says he can have faith in God instead of being driven by fear. Now, that's a question. This is kind of the application point of the talk here. Do you find yourselves making decisions based on your fears? Do you find yourself trying to mitigate risk out of everything so that you don't have to fail? Because when you mitigate risk out of things in your life, whether it's a job opportunity or a relationship or investments, whatever it is, when you take risk out of it, you also take the ability to have faith, because faith requires risk in our life. If we don't have risk, we don't need faith. And so David is talking about this idea that even in the valley, I'm going to be driven by my faith, not my fear. I fear no evil, even though I'm in a tough place. And here's why. Here's what he says: for you are with me. Look at these words: for you are with me. This is the only reason. Now, this doesn't take away from the scary place he's in. It doesn't mean that we don't have this dark period in our life where it's difficult, where it's scary. It's just that we are accompanied by God in it. And it's his presence that allows us not to fear. And the reason this is important for you to get, if you're going to grow in this relationship with your Creator, is you've got to understand that all we need is his presence. And what we as Americans kind of like is that when God works, and so we define quite quickly the things that we need God to do in our life to take away the scary circumstances that we find ourselves in. In fact, that valley for me causes me to pray like crazy. Right? You find yourself in a difficult place, either with your children or with your health or with your marriage or with your finances. Something's going wrong somewhere, right? And it just, if you're a faith person at all, it just drives you to have a conversation with God. Most of my conversations, however, isn't about, God, I'm so grateful that you're here with me during this difficult time. It's, God, here's what I need you to do to take away the difficult time. You ever do that too? Tell me yes. Oh, I felt like such an idiot for just a minute there, but you're dumb with me. Perfect. And we spend a lot of time, telling God how to take away the valley of death, the valley of the shadow of death, this dark place in our life. And I'm not saying you shouldn't do that, because, quite frankly, let's just be real. Sometimes that's all you got. You don't have the wherewithal in your life in these moments to say, God, thank you so much. I mean, if your faith's not big at the moment in time where you end up in this valley, and again, you just turn a corner from the green pasture and there you are in the valley. The phone rings and there you are. It's just a momentary moment. And all of a sudden, here I am. And I know we ask God to do certain things. I don't want to take that away from you. I'm just saying I want you to consider something else as well. I want you to consider this idea that just the fact that God's presence with us is supposed to help. It's like when you're a kid and you were scared and your dad showed up or your mom showed up. Just their presence, even though they didn't do anything, just their presence helped. You know, it's like if you went through a bad neighborhood with a lot of crime and you go through this neighborhood by yourself. You know, there's a lot of neighborhoods like this in Houston. I've been spending a lot of time in Houston, and I've been trying to get to the neighborhood and understand the neighborhoods around the West End campus. And I found myself taking a few wrong turns, and there I was, you know, and everybody looking at me. And I realized in this particular neighborhood, I was the only white person I could see. And I'm just like, whoa, what's going to happen here? And, you know, you just got this, like, fear that just comes from my evil prejudice or whatever it was. But this was not a good neighborhood. In fact, I told some police officers later where I was. They go, what were you doing down there? I said, buying drugs. No, I didn't. Just keep you on your toes right there. So just pawning some stuff. You know, but that's the kind of neighborhood. But if I go into that same neighborhood with a police escort, I'm like, come on, man. Here I am, middle-aged white guy right here. I got the cops with me, brought the popo. Here I am. What you going to do, you know? Because it's who's with you that makes the difference. You see my point? It's kind of a dumb example, but do you see my point? I mean, you understand that, right? It's who's with you. It's like, man, I'm totally vulnerable by myself out here, but I got God on my team. God's with me here. You know, I'm not gonna be susceptible to all kinds of evil because God is with me. And then he gives more description to that. He says these words. He says, "Your rod and your staff, will they comfort me?" Here's what he's saying. There's two things listed here that you don't think about with a shepherd. One of them is the staff, but the thing that he's talking about here, the first, is the rod. Now that's a piece of metal. And it's just a big stick, and it's got kind of a weapon at the end. And the shepherd would take one of these weapons with him, this rod made out of iron, to beat off anybody or anything that was invading the sheep. Anything that would attack the sheep, a wolf, a lion, whatever it was, man, the shepherd, because those are his valuable prized possessions, would come and defend the sheep. So it was a weapon. It was an offensive weapon to make sure that the sheep were safe. So when David is saying, you're with me, not only that, you've come well equipped. You know, you got your weapon, and then you got this staff. Now, a staff's not a weapon. A staff is that crooked, that stick with a crook in it. The shepherd would lean on it, but it also, the reason that it's got a crook in it, hook in it, is when a sheep, especially a baby sheep, would get out of line or in danger, that shepherd could reach around with that hook and grab the back leg of a sheep and pull that sheep back into line, right into the flock. So it was a directive tool. So when David is saying, God, man, I'm going through this tough time, this valley, but man, you got the weapon. You're with me and you're well equipped. I'm okay. So instead of sitting around fearing what could happen in this valley, I'm just going to walk through it, get to the other side, because I know you got an offensive weapon to defend me and you're going to keep me in line. That they comfort me. And so this is going to take a lot of discipline on your part to remember these kinds of truths from Scripture when you're going through a difficult time. You're going to have to come to grips with the fact that God's with you. He'll never leave you or forsake you. He sticks closer than a brother. These are all my favorite passages, by the way, that you've got to say, God is with me. You're going through a difficult time. I'm going to be okay. Daddy's here. God's with me. I don't know what he's going to do, and it still looks dark out here, and it's scary, and I'm going through the valley, and I can't see the end of the valley. But God's with me, and he's well equipped. He's going to beat off the enemy. He's going to keep me in line. I'm comforted. Let's go. I want to get out of this valley as quick as possible. There's been plenty of difficult times in my life where I've prayed this prayer. I've said, God, I don't know why I'm going through this, but whatever reason you have and whatever it is that you want me to learn, may I be a good student because I want to get out of here as quick as I can. That's a good way to pray. God, there's got to be something I can learn. There's got to be growth in my life. There's got to be a way I can depend on you and trust on you and more and more. And this valley is going to create deeper levels of faith. But I want to develop those deeper levels of faith, and I want to move on. I want to get to the green pastures and the still waters. I like that. Let's get back to there. And God's going, okay, let's go. And so that's the idea. So if you're going through a valley, you got to remember, God is with me. Whether you recognize it or not, God is with me. Let's say that together, even in Missouri City. Ready? Let's say it together. Ready? God is with me. And sometimes, fake it till you make it, folks. When you're in a valley and you're overcome with fear and you don't know what's going to happen and your mind is just wondering, you're not taking every thought captive. Man, you're just letting your mind wander and wander and wander. Just say to yourself, but God is with me. And I don't know what that means. I don't know what God's going to do. I know he's got a rod and a staff. He's going to use them. God's with me. Say it one more time. Ready? God is with me. And when you say that to yourself, it gives you a sense, this, I'm not alone in this valley. That's the worst thing to feel, is when you're going through difficulty and you've experienced loss, is to feel like you're all alone in it. Wow. God's with you. We got to move through the rest of this very quickly here. It says, by the way, there's a couple other little things here. Notice in this structure of this poem that he's talking about the Lord is my shepherd. And then down here he says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. This is the first time in the psalm that David talks to God directly. And it's like at the very beginning of the psalm, he's saying, man, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, life is good. But when life gets home, God, you're with me. I mean, you start having a first-person conversation with God. I mean, it's all kind of religion into this point, you know. When you go through a difficulty, you're going to say, okay, God, you are with me. And then he changes the motif again. He says this in chapter, in verse 5. He says, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Again, a first person, you're doing this, okay? And you prepare a table for me. Now, he changes this idea of being a sheep to being a man, because sheep don't eat at tables. At least the sheep I know don't. A man, a woman, the kids, they eat at tables. And so he's saying, you prepare a table for me. And I was thinking about, what does that mean? Well, in the Middle East, a meal is really quite an honor. And what he's saying there is, in fact, when a person wanted to show off their wealth, it wasn't really about their house or their chariot or their cell phone. It was about how many people they could feed. And they would invite big parties of people in and feed them. And when you wanted to show off how much money you had, you threw a big banquet. That's why a banquet and a banquet table is kind of a theme throughout the Old Testament especially. And the ideal here is that David is saying, man, you're wealthy. You threw this big banquet for me and you invited me. And you are providing for me. Even in fact, my enemies are looking at this and must envy. I'm sitting at the rich guy's table. And haven't you ever been seated at a table of honor? You know, that kind of deal. And so that's what David's drawing out is, not only are you well equipped in the valley, but somewhere after the valley, man, you are preparing a table for me and putting a feast on for me. You're wealthy. You're without end. You're without limits. You have all the resources I need. And we're going to have a celebration together. That's what a meal is, a celebration. And then he says this last thing, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. He personifies these two words, goodness and mercy. It's like they're real people, goodness and mercy. You know, goodness is that, God, you're morally good, and you're going to always be good to me. Even though I'm walking through this valley of the shadow of death, God, you're good. And you're going to be good to me. And you're full of mercy. That's a picture of grace. And grace is getting what you don't deserve. It's getting better than you deserve. It's the idea that God gives you mercy. That God loves you even though you act a fool from time to time. That God cares about you because he created you. He's not loving you because you're performing well. He just loves you. And that's grace. And that's mercy. And God wants to have a relationship with you based on those things, not based on your good religious behavior. And he's saying, David is appreciating this, as he's going through this valley, he says, God, you're wealthy and can provide anything I need on this deal, and you're good to me, and you're full of mercy, and they're going to follow me all the days of my life. In other words, what David is saying here is, even though I'm going through this valley and I'm going to come to green pastures, there's going to be another valley. There's going to be another difficult place. It's coming. And I know this, David says, I know that goodness and mercy will follow me throughout everywhere I go. I'm just not going to be able to shake you. I'm not going to be able to get rid of this. See, these are theological truths you have to believe to experience. And what we want to do is we want to experience goodness and mercy before we believe they exist. And God is saying through this psalm, no, I'm with you. I'll never leave you. I'm going to lead you through this difficult time, and goodness and mercy is going to follow you all the days of your life. I promise you, you're going to dwell in the house of the Lord all of your days and all of God's days for eternity because of God's goodness and because of mercy. And sometimes, this is the closing deal, sometimes you just got to stand on the truth of what God has said, because nothing in your world looks like that could be true. It's very difficult at difficult moments to see God's mercy and to see God's goodness. But you've got to know, as a faithful person, a person full of faith, that goodness and mercy follows you all the days of your life. That you are blessed and a very wealthy person is taking care of you, God the Father. And he's taking care of you so well, and he knows your needs, and you can't shake him, and you're going to get through this valley. Don't stop and camp out here. Keep moving forward. Attack. You know, a lot of people, Christians, well, I just don't know what I'm going to do. Man, this is so tough. I know it's tough. Keep moving. You get stuck in your grief, it leads to despair. You got to move forward. You get stuck in your marriage, you got to move forward. You got to get it off center. You got to go get some help. You got to do something. Don't be passive. Keep moving and keep moving and keep moving. If you're broke, if you spent money poorly, you didn't budget, do something about that. Don't play the victim. I had a nephew call my sister and say, well, I made a really bad grade on my test, and I could just punch somebody. My sister says, I want to be there when you punch yourself. And I'd like to see that. You keep moving forward. You fall down, you get up, you keep walking. You keep going. You quit listening to your feelings in the valley, and you go with the truth. And the truth is, goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. And God is setting a big table for you. You're going to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I know it's tough right now. I know what that's like. I've lived long enough and experienced it. But I know that the Lord is with you. He is going to take care of you. I promise you. Just believe it. Just decide today that you're going to believe it, regardless of what you see in this valley that you're in. Just decide to believe it. Let's close in prayer. Will you pray with me? Father in heaven, thank you so much for this truth right here. We just recognize and confess and acknowledge that in life we will all go through a valley, or two, or 10, or 100. We'll go through very difficult times. So may we learn, as people of faith, how to fear no evil, but to have faith in you, a loving God. How we may not be driven by our compulsion to fear. May we not play a prevent defense. May we not just try to cope with our fears based on avoidance. But may we, with great courage and faith, walk straight through the valley to the other side, believing that your rod and your staff, they'll be there for us. And I know there are many here that are struggling. Maybe on our Missouri City campus, they're going through a tough time with their children, or they can't have children, or they are having a tough time in their marriage or their jobs with this economy. May we all, God, cling to faith and truth and stand on it in a powerful way. And we pray all this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you. Hope you have a great weekend. You guys were smart for not now tomorrow with the spring forward. You don't have to do anything. Just stay in bed. There's folks down front that would love to pray with you and encourage you. God bless you. Are y'all leaving? I'm so talkative today. We could just, I'm feeling so good. We could just have a conversation. Okay, God bless you. Goodbye. Whatever.